Good evening, we are Tuesday, 31st of October 2017. In the financial news this week, three main topics. A potential one-off rate hike in the UK, the tech stock rally, asking ourselves whether it is 1999 all over again. And finally, in the markets, we look into the oil rally and the euro weakness. So, Bank of England is poised to raise interest rates on Thursday for the first time in more than 10 years. If it delivers a quarter point rate hike, and the odds on the market on it doing so are put at more than 80%, then it will be the first act of monetary tightening since July 2007. That was when interest rate rose to 5.75%. A decade without an interest rate rise is not unprecedented, but it is pretty unusual. The last time the cost of borrowing was unchanged for so long was in the wake of the Great Depression and during the Second World War, when rates tumbled in the wake of the financial crisis to a 300-year low. No one predicted that they would still be close to zero 8 years later. It is the most tangible sign of the damage caused to the UK economy by the credit crunch. What is less clear is whether this week's likely rate hike will mark the start of a return to more normal interest rates. The arguments for and against increasing the cost of borrowing remain finally balanced. There are good reasons to think that the reversal of last year's post-Brexit cut from 0.5% to 0.25% might not be followed by any further tightening for quite some time to come. So while the UK fared better in the wake of the EU referendum than many people feared it would, growth has taken a turn for the worse more recently, having been the fastest growing G7 country ahead of the Brexit vote. Britain is now the slowest growing leading industrialized nation. Growth is half that in the US and slower than Italy. Italy, which was until recently viewed as a sick man of Europe. So why might interest rates rise this week? Well, the principal driver is inflation, which hit 3% last month, a full 1 percentage point higher than the Bank of England's target. The Bank of England's main monetary policy goal is to control prices. Also, it has been prepared to allow inflation to rise above target before, if it is confident that the increase is just temporary. And that is the view of many economists. They see inflation as principally a consequence of the pound's post-referendum weakness, rather than a reflection of any underlying strength, let alone overheating of the economy. As such, price rises might be expected to fall back again as annual comparisons turn more favorable. The second reason to raise interest rates is to provide the Bank of England with some firepower if the economy turns down again in the future. And the problem with rates close to zero is that there is no room to lower them if the economy needs further stimulus. And the final reason to expect a move this week is just the Bank of England's credibility. Having warmed the markets up for rate rise, Governor Mark Carney risks looking indecisive if he fails to follow through with a hike. He has from here guided the market to a hike in the past and then failed to deliver. Now, on the other hand, the reasons not to expect much further tightening are related to the weakness in the British economy, and in particular, a lack of wage growth. We have seen a string of pro-economy data recently, including poor car sales figures and evidences of a weakening in the housing market. And perhaps more importantly, average earnings continue to lag inflation. In real terms, the UK is not better off than it was in 2006. despite the economy having grown in per capita terms. But workers are not just seeing the benefits. The outlook remains uncertain too. The stalling of the Brexit negotiation and the growing evidence that companies are reassessing their location strategy and investment plans ahead of Britain leaving the EU means growth could stay subpar for some time to come. So the chances are that the UK will get a rate hike on Thursday, but don't expect many more over the next year or so, and perhaps none at all. Now, the UK domestic economic outlook might look gloomy, but you'd never know it from the performance of the stock market, which continues to go from strength to strength pretty much around the world. In the US, the main drivers have been a batch of better than expected technology earnings reported and growing expectations that Congress might be getting closer to delivering President Trump's promised tax reforms. Big tech's profits are growing much faster than investors had forecast, with positive earnings surprises feeding through into sharply higher share prices in the past few days. Amazon rose by more than 8% on the back of a 34% rise in sales in the 3 months to September. Google owner Alphabet rose by 4% after a 24% sales rise. And Microsoft was nearly 7% higher, taking its market capitalization above the record it reached during the dot-com bubble. So, just like 18 years ago, tech stocks are driving the market higher, and they are sucking funds into the US market. In the past 3 weeks, more than $14 billion poured into US stocks as investors decided that better earnings justify the higher, historically higher valuation multiple for US stocks. Wall Street is continuing to hit record highs, with last week seeing the 49th record close in 2017. The US benchmark, the S&P 500 index, has now gone for nearly a year without recording even one 5% correction. A key difference with between the dot-com bubble time and now, however, is the fact that share prices are being driven higher on the back of improving earnings, rather than simply the expectation of future profits. So yes, this is a stock market rally driven by booming tech stocks, but it is not necessarily a rerun of the 1999 tech stock bubble. As well as tech profits, investors are focused on the prospects of significant tax reforms. A year on from President Donald Trump's election, the promise of tax cuts finally appears to be moving closer to realization. Having galvanized markets in the week after last November's election, the passage of legislation through Congress is once again pushing markets higher. That's good if tax cuts are actually delivered. But it does raise a risk, highlighted by Secretary Steve Mnuchin recently, that a failure to pass the reforms could see the markets give up a portion of their recent gains. The Trump administration has proposed a cut in the basic rate of corporation tax from 35% to 20%, a significant reduction that, all other things being equal, would leave more profits for companies to either reinvest in their business or to hand back to shareholders in the form of dividends or share buybacks. All of this would be good news for share prices, which is why the market has front-run the changes. Other possible reforms include measures to enable companies to repatriate earnings which are currently stashed overseas to avoid America's uncompetitive tax rate. Again, bringing that money home could boost investments or returns to shareholders. Back in the markets, another milestone was reached this week for oil. It was above $60 a barrel for the first time in more than 2 years. And breaking out of its recent trading range below that level is the latest sign that the market is tightening after a 3-year supply glut. Just since this summer, Brent crude has risen by 35% from last year's low of $45 a barrel, and it now stands more than twice its level in early 2016, when the price fell below $30. Oil has been boosted by strong demand as the global economy picks up pace in a coordinated uptick. And meanwhile, OPEC's coordinated cuts output have helped to offset the extra supply from the U.S. shale fields. It is thought that de facto, OPEC's leader, Saudi Arabia, has targeted $60 a barrel. Now, in currencies, the main focus of attention in the past week has been the euro, which has been hit by concerns from the ECB that it will extend its bond buying scheme until at least September 2018, even though it will reduce the rate of purchase to 30 billion euros amounts. The extended duration of European quantitative easing means that Europe is failing out of sync with US and perhaps the British tightening as well. Euro weakness, it fell by nearly 2% against the dollar in just 2 days last week, has given a boost to European exporters, and the Euro First 300 index was up by nearly 1% last week. That was beaten only by Japan among the major markets, which rose by 2.6% to record the seventh successive weekly advance and a new 21-year high in the wake of Shinzo Abe's victory in Japan's recent election. His victory has given a fresh impetus to his 5-year-old Abenomics program, emboldening him to call for a 3% private pay sector rise to finally kickstart the Japanese economy after decades in the doldrums since the 1980s boom. Well, that's all for today. I wish you a very exciting week, and I look forward to speaking to you again next week. Bye bye.